100 years ago, farmland looked like this, plowed with a team of horses, and today, at Tony Wallbank's farm, he would not give up a good team of horses for a tractor.
Right.
Well, that does a really good job.
Right.
I'm here just west of Princeton on the highway, too, and I'm here with Tony Wallbank, and the name's familiar.
That's right.
What did you do in your real life?
Well, before I retired, I manufactured precision springs and wire formings for the automotive industry.
That's where I've heard it. And now you've got what looks like a part-time job.
Well, no, actually, I've never worked so hard in all my life since I've been starting to farm with horses.
And you're going to teach us how to plow with horses.
That's right.
Yeah, and you do this because you can.
That's right, yeah. I've always had draft horses since my early 20s.
Wow.
And I've done it part-time. I've gone to General Motors Engineering or Ford in the day, and then I come home and I hitch up my team and I go plowing for a couple hours.
What does this do for you?
Well, it's a lot better than golf, I'll tell you that. Chasing that little white ball around the field, I'd rather plow up a golf course than lay on one.
Well, at the rate they're not bringing on new members, you may have your wish.
Well,
but
also,
tell us about these horses. What makes them special?
Okay, well, these are Percheron draft horses. They come in two colors, gray and black. And they came from France. They originated in a province called La Perche, near Paris. And they came from some Arabian stock back when the Muslims attacked France and Spain in hundreds of years ago, and when they finally got beaten back, there were Arabian horses left on the battlefields, and there were old small workhorses left. So they bred the two of them together and came up with a Percheron draft horse.
Now, if I were a knight, of years gone by, would this be a horse I'd want to have?
That's right. Yeah, you'd have a nice draft horse. And in England, they had the Clydesdales and the Shires, and in France, they had the Percheron horses. And they pulled large stagecoaches called dirigibles from city to city in France with six horses. Draft horses like these.
But I hear they only pull beer wagons here in North America.
Well, that's a misnomer.
I'm known for misnomers, Tony.
Yeah, actually,
why do you say that?
Well, actually, draft horses pulled everything right up until the beginning of the Second World War. The draft horses were used to take great-grandma's piano from the station, the train station, up the hill on a fancy team of horses and a nice wagon with a teamster driving it.
So you're now Oxford County's teamster.
Oh, I'm only one of many. There are many teamsters in the county.
I bet. Now, so are you going to teach us a little bit about how this machine works?
Sure. This is what they call a one furrow riding plow. And it was made by Oliver, which was an American company. They bought a plant in Hamilton called the Hamilton Plow Works, and for many decades they made their plows in Canada because of the duty. And so this plow is a 16-inch bottom, which is quite a wide bottom for Ontario.
Is the bottom there? Is that 16?
That's right. That's the width that you would cut.
Yeah.
That's the cut of the furrow, width of the furrow.
And why does this wheel look like it's busted?
Well, it's designed to hug the side of the furrow, the wall of the furrow.
Or to keep you going straight.
Keep it snug and keep the width constant. And so this large wheel is what they call the land side wheel. And this rear wheel runs on the land. And this wheel is the furrow wheel because it runs in the furrow. It's very similar to a tractor plow, similar.
But these have got all kinds of springs and levers and things.
Yeah, well, I kind of like springs, you know.
It runs in the family.
Always springtime at our place because we made a million springs a week in the old days.
But this looks, you know, I think of a plow as simply having the plow, of course, and, you know, you just pull it along. But this looks complicated.
Well, this is pretty standard, even for tractor plows, until Ferguson came along with a three-point hitch, and then you could lift the plow up with a three-point hitch, and that was pretty well the end of farming with horses then, because they were so handy. The Ferguson tractor, Massey Ferguson tractor came in, and you could back up that two-furrow, three-point hitch plow and drop it in the ground next to the fence, and off you go. And the horses couldn't compete.
So you've been living in almost the ancient ages when it comes to farming.
Well, this is a modern horse farming plow. This is one of the last ones that they made. The men all went to war, and there wasn't enough help on the farms, so the government subsidized the purchase of tractors, and those tractors with young girls driving them and the old fellas, that's what kept the productivity of farming up during the war. And when the soldiers, the young fellas, came back after the war, there's no way they were going to walk behind a team of horses. They'd driven in tanks and
they'd
driven in airplanes and you name it, and so they were going to farm modern with tractors.
What was the appeal for you though? Because it's different.
Keeping a tradition going, keeping our roots, keeping us firmly implanted in the traditions that made this country great.
And it does a good job, doesn't it?
Oh, yeah. Sure.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong with turning the soil this way.
No.
Yeah.
It does an excellent job.
It's really hard work for you, though.
Well, sitting on top of here is not too bad, but I do have walking plows too, you know.
Really?
And they're excellent exercise.
I bet.
I didn't know what kind of shape you were in when you were coming over here, but I would have had you
Thank you. Yeah, right. I'd sure be able to do that.
Yeah, there was over 6 million horses of these type used in the First World War. We've just celebrated Remembrance Day. And
pulling armaments and cannons and things like that.
Model T had only just come out when the war broke out, and they weren't too reliable for pulling huge cannons, as you can see.
With a little two-stroke engine.
So they had up to 16 horses pulling cannons up the hills to get them overlooking the enemy lines. And then they had to haul all their shells by horsepower, and every day, hundreds and hundreds of horses were killed because they couldn't get off the road when the shells came. And their bodies were just strewn on the roads in towards the front lines.
Percherons, I mean, they love to work.
Right.
Yeah.
They're not the only breed. There's also Clydesdales, as I mentioned.
Yeah.
And there's Belgian horses as well. They're quite a popular horse. And they guess where they came from?
Belgium?
Right.
Wow, thanks for the lesson. You know, the furrow is actually quite deep. How deep is that?
It's 6 inches.
Yeah.
5 to 6 inches, yeah.
Yeah, it does.
And like I said, it's 16 inches wide.
Wow.
And this is a green cover here, so I'm just plowing that crop down.
How long will it take you to finish this? How many acres are here?
Well, I don't put a whole full day of
me. Wait a minute. You don't complete your work here?
No. I just work till I get tired. But I do, if it can be raining, and if I'm in the mood, I'm out here in the rain, or if it's a skiff of snow, that's fine too.
All right.
It really looks nice when the snow on the ground and the furrow, the dark.
You know you've done a good job.
Yeah.
So we've met Tony, and I've plowed a few furrows, so now we're going to go across the street and meet the folks at Low Heat Stables.
Not quite as big.
What do you use this for?
Well, that would make him be okay in a parade.
Yeah?
Working, plowing, discing, any kind of farm work.
Now, you don't do that farm work yourself. Do you rent this horse out?
Oh, no, we do it ourselves.
Oh, yeah?
The way he's got 10 acres out back, and that's what we use the horses for, to put the field in and take it off.
Really, I could tell you a story about the Cubans are doing. They're going back in time for their agriculture.
Right.
I mean, you'd be able to use everything that comes out of this beastie, wouldn't you?
Yep.
Yeah.
Because
the
manure is just fertilizer.
Absolutely.
So I mean, and it don't cost nothing. The little bit of hay.
Is this breed happy to do work?
Oh yeah. Yeah, they love working.
Yeah.
Percherons all love work.
So the minute you start putting this on, she knows she's going to go to do something nice.
We'll be back in a moment with Moonlight and Bella. Stay tuned. So we've been having a way lot of fun here, but you do this on a fairly regular basis for all kinds of events.
Oh, yes.
Like?
Well, we have wagon rides. We have sleigh rides in the wintertime. We do special functions, like if a child is having a birthday party and their parents want to come out and, you know, either pet the horses, go for a wagon ride, sleigh ride. We do birthday parties, somebody getting married.
Not exactly sort of get in and drive. So when Randy and Pam need something different to do, Randy comes out here and works on this turn of the century, I mean the last century wagon. He's not quite finished yet, but time will tell. Oh, you bring your wagon to,
to
a big camp out.
Yeah, and we go to somebody's farm, and we get, oh, there's usually 10 or 12 wagons and horses. So you bed your horses down for the night, and then we all get around the campfire, and then we sleep in our wagons.
So do you talk to each other about who has the best wagon?
Oh, yeah, everybody brags about who's got the best wagon, who's got the best horses.
And and so how long is it going to take you to sort of recover this?
Well, like I say, this here I'm going to leave as close to natural
just
as I can.
On the outside,
I'm going to put a finish on it, and then I'm going to put these hoops on that will, I'll get a tarp made in Woodstock. There's a guy that'll make me the tarp for it.
Uh-huh.
And then when we're done, I'll just take these hoops off, and it'll be just a wagon, and we'll just ride around in the...
Now, where's the engine in this wagon?
It's in the barn there. You see two of them in there.
So you would have a team of two horses.
Two horses pulling.
And this thing that's sticking out here, this blue thing, is that a brake?
No, it's just a... There's one on either side. To keep the box from sliding from side to side.
It's a peg.
Yeah, just a peg.
Oh, I thought, how do these things break?
Well, your horses do it.
Your horses do it, right? So these wheels and the guts of it are as you got it, right?
Yep. They're original.
Yeah. And so how old do you think this wagon is?
Well, like I say, this part here, I bought off of Tony, and the wife went back to this new Dundee place,
right.
And it went back to the 1800s.
Wow.
Now this place is burnt. I guess this lumberyard's burnt three or four times. And we were gonna go up and find the owner or one of the kids or something, but the last known relative died about a year ago. So we're gonna go up to New Dundee and ask around, because some of the older farmers will know this company.
Yeah, and tell you a little bit about the wagon.
But right now it's a, I think the wife's got it down to, it's Castle Lumber now.
Oh really?
In New Dundee.
Yeah, yeah. How do people find out where you were at? How do they get in touch with you?
They can look at our website.
Which is?
Which is lawheedstables.com. Lawheedstables.weebly.com. And or they can call me. It's 226-228-2974.
That's a cell phone.
Yes, it is.
So apparently I did okay. Okay. On the plowing, even though occasionally the horse got out of the furrow, he's got to stay in this furrow. But Tony's a good good teacher. Yeah, I might just do this for a living. Anyway, for Oxford County Living, I'm Mike Harding.